First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. We back once again, Dr. Alim Bey Show. And tonight, we're going to get into the anatomy of God. Now, for those who might not have seen my Anatomy of the Body of God DVD, there's going to be a lot of information coming from that DVD, as well as also added in info, you know, which that we have. So let's jump right into it. Isha Sawala D. Lubix, in her books, her Bach, it was two volumes. She was married to R.A. Sawala D. Lubix, who wrote the book Temple and Man, and he wrote another book, The Temple of Man. And they lived like 15 years in the temples and tombs of Luxor and Karnak. You know, of course, you know, they say that they're tombs. However, you know, that's something in which that is also debatable. But the whole point of them staying there for 15 years was basically in order to try to penetrate the secret symbolism of the hieroglyphics or the Metuneta or Metunetur. Now, if you go to, I think, George G. James' book in his Stolen Legacy, and he speaks about the virtues, because the Egyptian priests, or the ancient Egyptian priests, or the Temerians, or Kamau priests, took great care in selecting and accepting candidates into their temples. All right? If you go to George G. James' book, Stolen Legacy, you can get the neophytes' requirements that they had to manifest in order to even get initiated. The life of virtue, as required by the Herbach or the Hakka, which is the ancient mystery teachings, it said you had to learn how to control of thought, control of action, or justice, steadfastness of purpose or fortitude, identity with spiritual life or higher ideals, temperance, evidence of having a mission in life, evidence of a call to spiritual order of the priesthood and the mysteries, freedom from resentment. You know, even when experiencing prosecution and wrong, right, that was actually known as courage. Confidence in the power of the master as teacher, and confidence in one's own abilities to learn, both attributes being known as fidelity, readiness and preparedness for initiation. So those were just, you know, those were some of the qualities, you know, that they looked for. And, of course, that's where the African proverb or the ancient Egyptian mysteries of Egypt proverb, you know, that when the pupil is ready, the master will appear. You know, so that's actually what you already had to exhibit prior to even getting initiated into the mysteries or the Herbach or the Hakav. All right, and so we have that there's several African proverbs, you know, which that, for example, the body is the house of God, and that is why it is said that man know thyself, or man know thyself, and thou shalt know God in the universe. Also, all is within yourself. Know your most inward self, and look for what corresponds with it in nature. These are the things that we're going to go over tonight. Now, those are African proverbs, or ancient Egyptian proverbs coming from the Metu Netter. That's in the book Egyptian Yoga, Volume 1, by Dr. Muwatta Ashby. Now, of course, the scriptures in which that correlates with that, particularly in the script in the Bible. You know, this is for, you know, you good Christians. You know, 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? And that if any one defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Now, 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you were bought at a price? Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. 2 Corinthians 6:16-18. For you are the temple of the living God, and God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my son and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. So, this is apparent that these scriptures that's in the Bible is correlated perfectly with the ancient Egyptian philosophy, or the ancient Kamal, or the ancient Tumerian philosophy. When you get the Temple of Man by Swallow-DeLubitz, he correlates this perfectly to the structures of the temples. For example, like the Temple of Heru, they overlaid the human anatomy, the skeleton system, the structure over the Temple of Heru, and it correlated perfectly. And you'll find the same correlation in the mosaic, in the Old Testament, in the mosaic temple structure of the outer gates, the holy place, and the holy of holies. This is the exact same structure that you find. So, you had the great temple of Heru of Beti Ed Ifu, or Edfu, in which that basically dealt with the transformation stages from lower self to higher self. And when you see these particular structures that's based on the human body, like, for example, the inner sanctum is the Holy of Holies. which that was only accessed by the Pharaoh or his representative alone. This is where, in the Mosaic structure of the temple in the Old Testament, only a priest or pure thoughts could enter into the room, which is the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was. If he had unclean thoughts, he would be destroyed almost instantaneously. This was shown on the movie Raiders of the Lost Ark, Part 1. Because basically you're on sacred ground. That's what that's symbolic to. The mind actually is the Garden of Eden or the Mecca, in which that is spoken of within the Bible as well as also in the Holy Quran. So the head symbolizes the Holy of Holies, the holy place symbolizes the torso, and the outer gates symbolizes the lower extremities of the genitalia and the anus or rectum area, as well as also the legs symbolizes Jassin and Boaz, the pillars, and then of course the third pillar symbolizes the phallus symbol, the penis or the tekin, or the body itself, as well as also symbolizes the left and right hemisphere of the brain, also symbolizes the left and right lung. So you have this duality going on, in which that splits down what is known as the conceptional and the governing vessel of the body, which is down the middle and up the back of the body. And when you look at, when you translate this information into the Mosaic text or Hebrew, particularly, you'll find that Yahivahi, when written on top of each other, Yah, then he, then Va, and then he again actually comes in the shape of man. But yet, Yahivahi is the Tetragrammaton, the name of God. And yet, when you use those symbols, it has the shape of man. You know, Yah symbolizes in geometry of the number 10. He is 5. Va, or wa, is 6. He, again, is 5. And what we're talking about is fire, water, air, and earth, the four elements. And when they are combined, that's ether, which is spirit, which is mind. So Yahivahi is Yahuwah, you know, which symbolizes man, which equals the mind, and or Yahawah, which is the woman, which it was also the universal mind. So that's the way in which that this information is broken down. And when you look at particularly the DNA, and of course we know that the DNA is produced by proteins, and these proteins are known as amino acids. You have 4 amino acids, in which that normally in science they just say CATG, which is cytosine, adenine, thymine, and guanine, which are the nucleic acids that determines the complex process of heredity. Now, the sequence of these 4 bases or nucleotides is what gives us this genetic code for all life, for all forms of life, and without life as we know it would have never evolved. It forms the rings in the DNA spiraling ladder. All right? Now, of course, we know that this ladder is mentioned, you know, as Jacob's ladder. I think it's in Genesis, the 28th chapter, 12th verse. It speaks about, behold, a ladder is set up on the earth, and the top of it reaches the heavens, and below, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. So it symbolizes your DNA, you know, which is the elliptical pattern. It also symbolizes the Kundalini energy, or the Kundalini Shakti, or the Shakti. Sekhmet was a daughter of Ra. She symbolizes the destructive or the chaotic side of Maat. All right, so these four elements, Yahi-Vahi and C-A-T-G, is the same. This is what they were saying with Yahi-Vahi, that these four amino acids or proteins, that when they arrange three at a time, as it forms a double-strand helix, all right? Now, there's 10 strands on which that is non-coded, which is called junk DNA, in which that, in the Old Testament, I think it's in the Book of Kings, it speaks about God removed from out of his sight the 10 tribes of Israel, and there was only two tribes on which that remained, in which that normally is mentioned as Dan and Judah. And then, of course, by the time of the New Testament in the Book of Revelations, the 10 tribes come back, or the 10 strands or the 10 vibes reemerge. And now there's 12 tribes of Israel again, which symbolizes the 12 strands of DNA, the 12 physical strands of DNA, and then, of course, the 12 ethereal strands of DNA, which give us 24, as in the 24 elders. That correlates to that. And, of course, the 12 pair of cranial nerves that sits around the pineal gland, which we'll get into that in a few. But, when these four amino acids are combined, you also have Yahi-Vahi, in which that comes up to 5-6-5-10, right, or 10-5-6-5, it comes up to 26. And, of course, 2 plus 6 is 8, you know, which we'll get into the number 8 in a second. But we also going to get into how it correlates to this DNA. It's because Yod is 10, and then when Yod and He comes together is 15, and then Yahi-Va comes to 21. And when you add that together, 10, 15, 21, it comes to 46. Now, 46 is important because if you get the book by David Godwin, the Kabbalistic Encyclopedia, Adam numerically or in geomantria equals 46. And when you go to the Old Testament, Genesis, the fifth chapter says Adam and Eve, God named Adam and Eve Adam. So hence the number 46 symbolizes both of them in that regard. And man has 23 pair of chromosomes, and women has 23 pair of chromosomes, or 23 chromosomes, and women have 23 chromosomes, in which that totals 46 chromosomes that produce life, human chromosomes. All right, so that's no coincidence. That's the reason why the atom numeral value is 46. Now, when you get into, now, even in geometry again, or numerology, Hebrew numerology, if you take the A off of Adam and just leave the Dam, which Adam and Dam both means blood or red. Now, you take the A off of Dam, just leave them, them comes up to 45. And then when you look at Eve in geometry, it comes up to 19. So 45 plus 19 equals 64, as in the 64 permutations or permutations of DNA, which is similar to the 64 hexagrams of the I Ching, or the Book of Change, or the Book of Transformation, which also symbolizes the 64 squares are red and black on the chessboard or checkerboard. Now, of course, if you get the book, Ancient Future by Wayne Chandler, he speaks that originally it was 256 portions of what was part of the IFA, of the Akan system of West Africa, in which that was taken into Asia by Bodhidharma and broken down for them to understand by 64. But it came from 256 originally. Now, what that would be symbolic to is that the 64 could symbolize the two strands of DNA, the two helixes, and the 256 also as in the non-coded DNA, known as junk DNA. Now, in Arabic, you know, we would say Allah. And of course, you know, in English we have arm, leg, arm, head, which of course is A-L-L-A-H. If you take the first letter off of each of those words, in which that would be the acronym for Allah. And it is true. And this is within the Nation of Gods and Earth teachings, as well as also within the one, which is the 120, as well as also within the student enrollment lessons of the Nation of Islam, lost and found Muslim lessons of the Nation of Islam. So actually, man will be Allahi. The I and the dot will symbolize the phallus symbol, and the dot symbolizes the sperm. And the woman will be Allahu. And the U symbolizes the uterus and the womb. And together they form the Elohuma, or which is within Hebrew is Elohim. Or in English, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and end. Which is within Hebrew, Elohim, or Alim in Arabic, which means the universe or and the all-knowing. This is why Adam, when he had sex with Eve, and she conceived, it says that he knew Eve. So Adam and Eve knew each other at that point. So knowledge is gained through the sexual act. That's the way it's supposed to be. However, we've lost the divinity in that. And now we look at it as something as a pastime. And this is a shame. But this is what's going on. Also, if you get into Freemasonry, like in the inter-apprentice degree in Freemasonry, it reveals that God is an acronym. And so God stands for Guma, which means wisdom, Oz, which means O, which is, you know, G stands for Guma, meaning wisdom. The O stands for Oz, meaning strength. And the D stands for Dabar, meaning beauty. All right, so G-O-D, wisdom, strength, and beauty, becomes the acronym. Now, in Arabic, there's the equivalent to that. And the equivalent is El Hakim, which is the wise, which is the 46th attribute of Allah. So hence, once again, 23 plus 23 chromosomes of male and female comes together to form 46. So hence, wisdom, knowledge, once again, comes together from that intimacy or from that sexual act in which that produces life. All right, and then that's El Hakim. Do you have El, which is the wise? You have El Mukit, which is the strengthener, which is the 39th attribute of Allah. And you have El Musawir, which is the fashioner, which is the 13th attribute of Allah. Now, when you add 46 plus 39 plus 13 up, and you break it down like in numerology to the lowest denominator, is like 4 plus 6 is 10. And then, of course, 1 plus 0 is 1. Or 3 plus 9 is 12. And then 1 plus 2 is 3. And 1 plus 3 equals 4. You know, so 1, 3, and 4 is, you know, 1 plus 3 plus 4 is 8. So that comes back once again to Yahivahi, in which that comes up to 26, and 2 plus 6 is 8. So 8 symbolizes the 8 dividing cells of mitosis, which forms the physical body into existence. For those 8 cells, or cellular division, also referred to as blastopores. And as a matter of fact, those same 8 cells right now are located in your sacrum, a bone area, and those 8 cells never change your whole entire life. And you have 76 trillion cells in which that makes up your body, in which that changes over a 7-year period, but those 8 never change the whole entire lifespan. That is what produces the Kundalini energy, that atomic force. And so, in English, we know that we got 26 letters in the alphabet. And the reason for that, of course, is because of what Yahibahi means or comes to in numeral value is 26. So we have 26 letters in the English alphabet. And, of course, if you get use the various names of God, like in Hebrew, like, for example, El, E would be 5, L would be 12, and, of course, 5 and 12 is 17, and then 1 plus 7 is 8. So L comes up to 8. Elah, which is the same word as Allah, or Elah, you know, is 5, 12, 1, and 8, which comes up to 26, and, of course, 2 plus 6 is 8. Then Elohim, which is 5, 12, 15, 8, 9, 13, which comes up to 62. 62 plus, you know, is 6 plus 2 is 8. And then Elion is 5, 12, 25, 15, 14, which is 71. And 7 plus 1 equals 8. So El, Elah, Elohim, Elion all comes up to the mathematical number of 8, which symbolizes those same 8 dividing cells of mitosis that we just spoke about. Even God, you know, equals 7, you know, G equals 7, O equals 15, D equals 4, which comes up to 26. 2 plus 6 is 8. You know, Yahivahi, you know, which is YHWH, which is 25, 8, 23, 8, which comes to 64. You know, which, when you add Yahweh to it, which is 25, 1, 8, 23, 5, 8, comes to 70. And then you add 70 plus 64, comes to 134. And then 1 plus 3 plus 4 is 8. And even with Adonai, 1, 4, 15, 14, 1, 9, comes to 44. 4 plus 4 equals 8. So the name of God in Hebrew and Arabic and English comes up to 8, which symbolizes those 8 dividing cells of mitosis that we just finished speaking about. And this is supreme mathematics that we're talking about. According to the Nation of Islam, you know, the question is, what is the birth rate question? Well, man is God himself, his environment, and the universe in which we live. That's the answer. You know, so, I mean, this is just, you know, this is information that we got to come to realization of. We got, the heavenly correspondence to the earthly body, we got to get into that information too. For example, I seen some information online today in which that I had to go deeper into. Like, for example, when you go to Het Heru, the temple of Het Heru, and you go there to the Giza Plateau or to Egypt, you go into the temple of Het Heru and you look up, and you see that the Dendera is also referred to as the temple of Dendera. But that's the hieroglyphics there, or the Metunata, but it is of the zodiac. All right, it's up to Zodiac. Now, what we say is Aries, coming from the Greek Roman transliteration, is actually our men. Taurus is Osar Apep, Osiris. Gemini is Osar Oset, which was changed to Osar Set. Cancer is Kepra. Leo is Atum. The Virgo is Oset. Libra is Mayat. Scorpio is Sarket. Sagittarius is Shu. Capricorn is Mendez, as in the Golden Mendez, which is also where the Baphomet symbol comes from, or originate from. Aquarius is Heru. And Pisces is Sebek. So, this is how it's broken down at the Temple of Dendera. Also, as far as these particular signs, and we know that the zodiac plays an influence because light travels, and we're looking at points of light or vectors of light, which are stars. And it's no coincidence that scientists have now come to find out that our physical body is composed of stardust. And it's no coincidence that 300,000 tons of stardust energy or particles fall to the planet Earth daily. And being that you're in the image and after the likeness of God, which you are the microcosm of the macrocosm, which is the universe, you as a melanated being who possess dark matter in a physical form, your mission is to absorb the light. The more absorbed, the more a person absorbs the light, the more evolved matter becomes. All right? So, this is what's going on. Now, how do you absorb the light? Well, one of the things was that you do 25,920 times within a 24-hour span, which correlates to the sun going through the 12 zodiac signs, as well as also our solar system going and rotating around Sirius constellation every 25,920 years, is that that correlates to the breath, and the breath affects the whole body. The nervous system, the heart, the digestive system, muscles, sleep, energy levels, concentration, and memory, and much more. Breathing is our largest system for waste removal. 70% of the waste produced in the body is supposed to be removed by breathing. 20% through via the skin, and 10% through the kidneys and the digestive system. 70% is supposed to be removed by breath. But because we are so shallow breathers, that is not happening. So sickness happens, illness, disease. And this is the problem that's going on. You see what they're doing, trying to cut down on you absorbing this solar phatic energy, the stardust energy, because the sun is a star. And right now it's going through a solar flare activity or corona mass ejections, and there's mega... So there's solar flares or super flares, mega flares that are bombarding the planet Earth during this particular cycle. As a matter of fact, one just hit 2 days ago. And they were chemtrailing the sky like crazy because that's what the chemtrails are for. You know, the aluminum in it, which is the main ingredient in the chemtrails, is to reflect light, to block out the energy. And that's so they won't get burned up in the process and be revealed as the reptilians as they are, lower nature beings, you know, and we transmute to godhood and move from the third dimensional density level to the fifth dimensional density level. The third dimension is based on length, width, and height. The fourth dimension is based on time, space, or depth. The fifth dimension is based on energy. They're third dimensional beings, and actually we are fourth dimensional beings, and you can tell that by our hair follicles. I broke this down before. And you'd get a portion of this information in The Ankh, written by, introduction was written by Heru Samaj, who's the husband of Queen of Hua and brother Nur Amin, who actually wrote the book, The Ankh. And I have to bring this up about VHF, which is very high frequency. Talking about the hair antennas are straight hair, just like the straight rabbit hair antennas that used to be on the TVs, which gave you access to channel 2 to channel 13, which was very high frequency. If you wanted to go to ultra high frequency, which was highest stations or channels, that would be from 14 to 83. And that antenna was shaped like a ohm. The matter of fact, it was called an ohm antenna, as in ohm. And the shape of it is the same as our hair follicles, that that spirals in an 8 and 9 fashion. And that shows that we are fourth dimensional beings, and we're being held down, as folks say, lockdown cold transmission. In other words, our DNA is being locked down. Why do you think they come out with genetically altered food in order to stop and inhibit and block this change from happening? So now, brothers and sisters are out of shape, fat, bloated, obese, because of the foods in which they eat, as compared to the Europeans, or Albions. White girls now have butts, shapes. Where that came from? That wasn't there 20 years ago. But they do now, because it's genetically altered food, or GMOs, or genetically modified organisms. And it's called organisms because it's living. There's something in the food in which that is living, and obviously it's not to help, but obviously to stop this connection to the stars, to inhibit our connection to the stars. But breath, breathing, is one of the things in which that still have to be mastered, regardless of the chemtrails. If you need to, on the days in which that there are no chemtrails, you need to be practicing your breathing exercises. Otherwise, when there's chemtrails, you need to be doing it in your home with an air purifier. And the reason why, because when you break down, when you go to Aleister Crowley's book, 777 Kabbalistic Writings of Aleister Crowley, he states in there that 888 in the Kabbalistic writings of Gematria, 888 equals Jesus Christ. And he's right. What is on the periodical chart? On the periodical chart, the number 8 is oxygen. Oxygen has 8 protons, 8 neutrons, 8 electrons. 888. What is oxygen? Well, there's a force within oxygen in which that the ancients knew about. It was called Ra during the ancient Kemetic time. It was called Prana in India. It's called Qi in China. It's called Ki in Japan. In Christianity, they call it the Holy Spirit, or Ruach in Hebrew. The wind. Well, this air, wind, breaks down to also in ancient times as Shu. And you go and do your metanata studies, and you'll find that Shu is depicted as a black man with long hair. And I'm saying black as far as his description. Nationality-wise, he was a Kamau or a Tamarian or Tamorian as far as nationality-wise, which would be a Moor. But the thing is that he shows, it is shown that Shu is what separated Geb and Nut on the stills of the Matunatas. At first, Gavin Newt was there, and there was no separation except the phallus of Gav stuck up straight, erected, resurrected towards the Tekin, the phallus, towards the womb of Newt, symbolizes the impregnation of the universe and of the earth itself. Newt symbolizes the sky, Gav symbolizes the earth. And then in the next still, you would see Shu replacing the phallus. So Shu also symbolizes the semen, the sperm, the breath. So it's through the breath on which that you manufacture, brothers, semen, and give life to the sperm, which forms new bodies into existence. It's through your breath. So this means that the chemtrails is also another form of population control agenda, along with the vaccines, along with the GMOs, along with many other facets, war, famine, disease, all part of the Global Report 2000, written by Jimmy Carter in 79, signed, in which that stated, 2.7, 2.8 billion non-white people must be eliminated from the face of the planet, preferably by famine, drugs, disease, and war. This is the same old programming or program. And so we must break that cycle. So breath or breathing is the foundation for healing energy. Matter of fact, the longer exhale triggers the vagus nerve, which is one of the 12 pair of cranial nerves that sits around the pineal gland, and which that is very important to the system that relaxes the body, which is part of the parasympathetic nervous system. Nevertheless, Shu, within the ancient Kemetic texts, he symbolized the personification of the air. And it's no coincidence that Jesus Christ, now we talked about Gab and Newt. Let's put that in equivalence to the Old Testament with Yahweh, Yah and Way. Yah symbolizes Newt, Way symbolizes Gab. The Old Testament deity was Yahweh, or Yahwah, okay? The New Testament is Yahshua. So Shu is embedded now in the New Testament with the name Jesus, you know, which is, of course, is an English transliteration of a Greco-Latin word, but coming from, which is Jew and Zeus. Jew, which is short for Jupiter, and then Jew, the Peter was removed, and Jew and then Zeus became Jesus, which became Jesus, and Peter became his right-hand man in the Old, in the New Testament. But they become Serapis, which is a form of Apis or Serapis, which is a form of Osiris or Osor by 325 AD by Constantine, with his meeting of 319 bishops, one excommunicated, which is Arian, who disagreed with what was going on. Some say there was more. However, this was called the Nicene Council. Nevertheless, Shu symbolized the personification of air. Shu means emptiness, and he who raises up. So in order to ascend the Kundalini energy, it's through what is called empty retention. It's through holding your breath after you inhale. And then after you inhale, you hold it. Then you exhale. Then you hold it. So through those empty retentions is what causes the Kundalini to raise up. This is what was actually being conveyed. And so Shu symbolizes Yahshua, which is Jesus in the New Testament, who is now in between God, was the Yahweh. So Jesus' name in Aramaic is Yahshua, or Yahshua. Also in Old Hebrew, Yahushua. But Yahshua becomes the Old Testament Joshua, also, who was the right-hand man to Moses, who did get a chance to take the people into the land of milk and honey, the land of Canaan. unlike Moses, who did not. So this person who took the people into the land of Canaan in the Old Testament becomes the same character in the New Testament, Jesus, Yahshua, Joshua, in which that symbolizes the breath. So the breath takes you into the land of Canaan, which symbolizes the land of milk and honey, which is talking about the particular hormones on which that is excreted from the pineal gland, the pituitary gland, which is whitish and yellowish in substance, in which that the yellow symbolizes honey, the white symbolizes milk, in which that, of course, becomes I guess we can call it serotonin, but actually it's DHT. All right. And then the pituitary gland produces its hormones, growth hormones, in which that we actually are supposed to still be using, but after puberty, we stop using it as growth hormone. All right, GH. In which that we no longer use, but it's still being produced, and it's supposed to expand us now, not, you know, physically, you know, in that way, but spiritually. So DHT and GH is actually those two chemicals in the brain, in which that is the land of milk and honey, and this is what is produced through the raising of the Kundalini energy into the brain centers. Hence, what produces those two. The cobra, as well as also the vulture on the tiara of the crown of the pharaohs. Now, for those that don't understand what I'm talking about, Yahshua, when you break it down in Hebrew, means salvation, or the Lord who is salvation in Aramaic. And I think it was John 14:6, where Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by or through me. So what is this life aspect that he's talking about? It's the breath. No one can get to the Father, which is the soul and the side of the pineal gland, to awaken the soul to become Heru from being Asar. Asar is the sleeping or the dead god, who must be resurrected from the grave. Hence, Jesus being resurrected from the grave comes through the breath, in which that transforms into Heru. Now, the clue in which that is given to you is the fact that when you sneeze, you say, Yahshua. Or Yahshua. It was giving you the clues. So, Yahshua symbolizes the breath, in which that is, the clue is given is that of the sneeze, because it tells you that Atum formed Geb, no, excuse me, formed Tefnut and Shu from a sneeze. Oh, Old Testament tells you, Genesis, that God breathed into the nostrils of man and made man a living soul. Same story. This is what me and Panda was talking about for the last 2 weeks, breaking it down on this information. So y'all privileged to this information tonight. You know, y'all getting a little bit of taste of this info. You know, so with the mastering of the breath and the posture, it opens and activates, if you learn how to raise the energy in a circular fashion called a microcosmic orbit or a macrocosmic orbit rotation, it opens 12 other meridians, in which that is symmetrical on the right and left side of the body, in which that energy, when it opens up, it helps regulate the particular organs in the body. Like, for example, between 3 a.m. to 5 a.m., the lungs are activated. Between 5 a.m. to 7 a.m., the large intestines are activated. Between 7 a.m. to 9 a.m., the stomach is activated. Between 9 a.m. 11 a.m., the spleen is activated. Between 11 a.m. 1 p.m., the heart is activated. between 1 p.m. to 3 a.m., the small intestines is activated. Between 3 a.m., 5 p.m., 3 p.m., 5 p.m., the urinary bladder is activated. Between 5 p.m. and 7 p.m., the kidneys. Between 7 p.m., 9 p.m., the pericardium. Between 9 p.m., 11 p.m., the triple burners. Between 11 p.m., 1 a.m., the gallbladder. And between 1 a.m. to 3 a.m., the liver. So, if you notice, it's a two-hour interval between each organ being activated in a 24-hour period, or these 12 meridians being activated. So, if you notice, normally your left and right side of your nostril, one of them is more clogged than the other one. But doing what is called the alternating nostril breath technique, you help balance and make even the breath pattern through both nostrils. So that means when you breathe in, prana is going to all 12 of these particular organs in a step-down transformer style, you know, based on the time periods, you know, evenly distributed. Unlike when one nostril is clogged up for 2 hours, then it becomes unclogged, and the other one is clogged up for 2 hours, then that's clogged up, then the other one is not clogged, and then it becomes clogged up again. Every 2 hours, one is clogged up. That's not the way it's supposed to be. So by mastering the alternating nostril breath technique, you synergize both hemispheres of the brain, in which that brings about this balance or mayat within the physical body. This is what you want. This is talking about longevity, all right? And once you learn how to light up your body like a Christmas tree, like what Panic was talking about the other week, last week, week before last, is that eventually you won't have to do any of these exercises because you will become a living vessel for this prana or chi or ki energy. But until then, you have to master these exercises and use these as tools in order to get to that awareness. At that point of when you have mastered it, then that's when you become an immortal. All right? So, let's go back a little bit to the microcosmic orbit. The key to mastering the microcosmic orbit, and that is basically storing energy into your lower dantian and your navel chakra, and then moving it down to your perineum, and then as you inhale up, you'll raise it up through your spinal column to the top of the head, the middle of the head, and then as you exhale, you take the energy and pull it down towards your perineum again. And then inhale up to the top of the head, exhale down to the perineum, inhale up, exhale down to the perineum. And by mastering that, there's two things that you must remember. Holding the tongue against the roof of the mouth connects the governing and the conceptional vessel, in which that forms what is called the small heavenly circle or the microcosmic orbit. Now also, you got to do what is called the Yu-Yin lock, which is actually the deer exercise technique that Stephen Chang speaks about within his book, Tao of Sexology, which is that you pull up your anal and perineum area as you breathe in and raise the energy upward towards the crown. And then as you let it down the front of the body, you can release it. And then as you inhale, pull it back up. Now what this does, it helps connect the points of the dew and the ren meridian, which is the governing and conceptual vessel, which is the transformation point of fire and water. And it's crucial that it be locked during the insulation so that no chi can leak out. And this is the key to maintaining energy. And for brothers, semen, okay, your semen, all right? So this is key to how to have an ejaculation instead of an ejaculation. All right, this is similar to the sisters when they do the Kegel exercises after childbirth, you know, for to strengthen the vaginal area, you know, area and everything. You know, so that's the key. Brothers, this works when you do this exercise hundreds of times a day. You can start out 100 times to get to as high as 300 or more daily during the D exercise or the Huyin lock, pulling up your anal and your perineal muscles, by doing that, what you strengthen is your prostate gland, which is your womb, brothers. And it's good for the sisters because it strengthens your uterus. All right, so we was talking about, too, is the storage place of this photonic energy. Like we said, the lower dantian, which controls the transformation of the gen to chi, or chi energy, which is at the navel chakra, just some say about an inch or two down below the navel chakra. We just say the navel chakra, because energy expands to 1 to 3 inches below the navel. And then you have the middle dantian, which is the heart chakra, and particularly the back of the heart, in which that controls the transformation of the chi to shen. And then you have the third eye, which is the upper dantian, which controls the transformation of shen to wu chi. Okay? And once you have come back, connected with wu chi, then you're able to, which is the essence, then you're able to become a portal or channel for this electromagnetic or photonic energy called prana, chi, or ki energy at all times. All right, this is very important in order to remember. As a matter of fact, one of the techniques is actually you can stand or sit in the chair with your spine straight, and you can actually bring both hands over your lower abdomen, actually over your navel chakra, and then as you breathe out, yeah, you can breathe out, you know, and in through your nose, and as you inhale, you can visualize a golden ball of energy like a sun growing in your lower dantian or navel chakra area, and as you exhale, visualize the golden ball intensifying its glow. And you can do that about 36 times, or practice at least 3 to 5 minutes. 10 minutes is ideal throughout the day. Basically, what this does is recharge your internal system, your energy. Another technique is what is called pranic breathing, in which that you can do what's called deep breathing with empty retention. Remember, we were talking about shu means empty, emptiness. Well, this is what this is. And we said you connect your tongue to your palate, as we said. You do abdominal breathing, so you'll focus on your abdomen. Inhale slowly and retain for one count, and then exhale slowly, and then retain your breath for one count before inhaling. This is called empty retention. This is what helps activate the kundalini energy and also expand your aura, as well as also drive prana into your chakra system. There's another way of doing it, 7171, which is another technique, and 6363. And you will breathe in for a count of 7, hold it for 1, breathe out for a count of 7, hold it for 1, or breathe in for a count of 6, hold it for 3, breathe out for a count of 6, hold it for 3. Okay? So these are exercises that you can do in order to drive, matter of fact, the prana breath technique actually expands the aura from 3 feet to actually 15 feet outside of the human body. And you actually feel a tremendous amount of prana rushing into all parts of your body when inhaling is done after empty retention. This is what is being shown on the walls of ancient Egypt with Shu. All this ancient information is within the various cultures. But because we don't do comparative religious study or decoding mythologies, various mythologies of the world, we miss the points of what these or what the ancients were trying to convey to us. So these are the things that we need to focus on. And as a matter of fact, once you learn how to master prana breathing, you can actually transfer energy to yourself, to places in which that might hurt within your body, as well as also to others. Now, let's go back. Let's look at this movie Because in the movie Matrix, Morpheus shows Neo a Duracell battery and told Neo that this is all we are to them. So true, we are a battery. A battery needs to be alkaline. Because when you get a fresh pack of batteries, it says on the alkaline batteries. So when the battery is alive and outputting electrical charge is alkaline. But when it is dead, it is acidic. So as our body is 25% acidic, 75% alkaline, it is recommended that we consume roughly 25% acidic food and 75% alkaline food, as our body is 75% water and 25% mass. So when the body is too acidic, you'll feel ill, sick, suffer from ailments and disease. So we know alkaline water and alkaline foods is electrical. So this is what the body needs to regenerate. And alkalinity has to be at least 7.4 in balance. That's basically the pH balance of the blood. But because of the foods in which that we eat, and 90% of the foods now, you know, are genetically altered, especially if you get it from out the supermarket, you know. Even whole foods are now controlled and owned by Monsanto. So we can't necessarily trust that either. The best thing is to grow your own food, and to grow it would be within a glass house. So it can get sunlight, but yet not the chemtrails. So these are the things that we have to master. Now, your body is a battery because of the melanin that you have. And melanin is viewed as a battery that is partially charged and can always accept an electrical charge. So when sunlight or other energies come in contact with the melanin battery, it increases the charge of the battery to a certain degree. Now, according to the Unk book, in the third dimension, there's a gap in between our melanin or melanocytes. And that gap is shown up in that the things which that we think about takes a period of time to manifest. However, if we move into the fourth dimension, fifth dimension, things begin to happen more instantaneous or quickly. It's called the quickening. That's the rapture. So when the energy is captured, the battery has more energy to use in the body. That means that the human being can charge up their melanin, right, with this unique ability of absorbing various energy sources and convert these absorbed energies into reusable energy. So this includes mediums such as music vibrations, sound waves, and this is why the music that we listen to, you know, has to be of a better kind, you know, that has some type of message to it, and sound waves. The sun rays, the sun heat, light rays, etc. Matter of fact, in Dr. Frank Barr's theory, he says matter is shaped and structured by light. These molecular combinations, which is melanin, eats light in order to maintain, expand, and evolve matter. So the more highly evolved a species, the more complex is biological capacity to use light. So vampires can't use light. They can't stand light. They run away from the sun. They can't utilize it. While those who are melanated can enjoy the sun. Matter of fact, the Albino European only needs about 15, 20 minutes of sunlight daily. However, a melanated being, in order to get the proper amount of vitamin D for our blood and for our bone structure, we need at least an hour. Now, this correlates perfectly to the sun being 93 million miles away. The 93rd attribute of Allah is called El Nur, which is the light. No coincidence. But it takes 8 minutes and 20 seconds for the sun rays from 93 million miles away to touch down to the planet Earth, while it takes exactly 8 minutes and 20 seconds for the blood within your body to circulate and to bathe the brain in nutrients. Once again, no coincidence. So you have seven chakras, major chakras. Some are developing 9, some we'll develop 12. But we're going to go up to 7 right now based on the book of Revelation. From Revelation 1 to Revelation 12, there's 7 chakras. There are 7 stars. By Revelation 12, there's 12 stars. So we jump from a 7 chakra system to a 12 chakra system. However, we're going to stick with the 7 chakra system. So 8 minutes, 20 seconds times 7 comes to 57 minutes and 40 seconds. So approximately an hour it takes to recharge our battery or our chakra system through the melanin. So we need at least an hour of sunlight a day. So melanin is the perfect superabsorber of light in all energy frequencies. Melanin can rearrange its chemical structure to absorb all energy across the radiant spectrum. Like we said, it's sunlight, x-rays, music, sound, radar, radio waves, and can transmute and store this energy for later use. All right, so when we're talking about in the martial arts field of Qigong, Tai Chi, there's 3 areas in the body that stores, or the storage for this photonic energy, electromagnetism. We said the third eye, the back of the heart, and the navel chakra, which is called the dantians. Now, you know your chakras are the wheels of light, color, and sound, and thoughts. And they are superimposed over your 7 major endocrine glands, your pineal gland, pituitary gland, thyroid gland, thymus gland, spleen, your adrenal glands, prostate gland, testicles within the male, and uterus and ovaries within the woman. And, of course, we have other glands that are growing. Dr. Malachi Ziyork speaks about the pituitary gland, which is under the submental area, which is under the chin area. Debbie Blair speaks about the mound area, which is in the upper roof or the upper palate of the mouth, which is called the epiphany gland, as referred to. It's also known within the Sanskrit as the talu gland. And it has a hole in it in which that goes directly into the third ventricle. And there's a substance in which that is excreted through that gland, in which that if you swallow it, it tastes sweet. And when you swallow it, you rejuvenate your cells. All right, this is real science, you know. It amazes me. The shit that we don't know about the human anatomy, the body of God. But, of course, 3/4 of the human body consists of water and is the main component of the physique, meaning that your tissues and organs are mainly made up of water. So your brain is 90% water. And when it can't maintain the percentage, it pulls water from the other organs of the body. Blood consists of 85% water, 90% actually. Muscles consist of 75% water. Your bones consist of 25% water. Your spinal column is 85% water. So the function of water in the human body is vital. So when we talk about alkalinity, your water must be alkaline. So you must get test strips. You can get them from Walgreens, Walmart. You can go to the pool section and get the test strips, or even in the drug section. And you can test the water and see if it's acidic. All right? It's important. The water, transport nutrients, oxygen into the cells, moisturizes the air in the lungs, helps with metabolism, protects our vital organs, helps our organs to absorb nutrients better, regulates body temperature, detoxifies, protects, and moisturizes our joints. So every cell in your body needs water. You know what I'm saying? So let's take, for example, your brain consists of 90% of water. Well, your brain is the largest sex organ. So your brain cannot function well. You cannot function well. All right, I think what's the name of the book? Green Leaves of Barley. It's written by Mary Swoop. She commented that that acid destroys the blood. And to maintain the blood pH balance of 7.4, and from the acid range, which is 7.0 and below, the body has a tendency to steal alkaline minerals from the bones. This would cause osteosporosis, bone deterioration, teeth to fall out your mouth. Your blood holds about 2/3 of oxygen. And that deals with the moisture. Once again, that deals with the shoe aspect. But when there's not enough water, for a matter of fact, when you 20% dehydrated, you risk death. Now, on the walls of ancient Egypt, or on the walls of Egypt right now, but they had what is called the Vault of Heaven, which is actually called the Ark or the Bark of Ra. They had a picture of the Vault of Ra on top of the head, turned upside down on Heru in the form of a hawk or a bird, and then on top of the Jid, which the word Jedi comes from. And on both sides, you had Isis on the left and Nepet on the right. This symbology symbolizes Heru and the sun, Dis, but it also symbolizes the two Marys, symbolizes the two nerves in the spinal column that comes up from the sacral bone area, called the two sacral nerves. Inside the Jid, or 31 nerves. So this 31 plus two nerves give us 33. The digit is broken down actually into 33 vertebrates, or 33 sections, which that correlates to Jesus dying on the cross at the age of 33, or Alexander the Great dying at the age of 33. That's what all these stories are actually talking about. Or 33 generations from Adam to David, and then from David to Jesus, 33 generations, or 66 books in your Bible. So you got 33 nerves and 33 vertebrates, and 66. So your body is actually the book of life. Now, the thalamus area symbolizes the Ra, the sun disk. The bark is the corpus callosum. The pineal gland symbolizes our saw. And then, of course, upon awakening, the pineal gland through the kundalini energy, which is all set, she resurrects our saw, transform him into her rule, to ascend to his, as they say, Jesus ascend to his father, to his father, which are in heaven, to the right hand side of God, which is talking about the activation of the right hemisphere of the brain, because we are linear thinkers, which only use about 10%, well, 2 to 10% of the left hemisphere of the brain. All right. So this is what all this symbolizes. Also, the pituitary gland also symbolizes Isis or Set. The medulla oblongata can also symbolize Horus or Heru. But the point is this, is that the pineal gland is the master gland located in the center of the brain. The pineal gland, hypothalamus gland, the pituitary gland comprises what is known as the third eye, the spiritual eye. And from a metaphysical perspective, it has been known to link between the physical and the spiritual worlds. It functions as a link to prophecy and increased spiritual awareness and consciousness. All right. Now, these three glands in the brain, which is the pituitary gland, the hypothalamus gland, the pineal gland, sits in the exact same alignment as the three pyramids on the Giza Plateau and the three stars in Orion's belt. That's no coincidence. As above, so below, as within, so without. The supreme axiom. So, when we look at this, we're actually looking at the pyramid, which is the head structure of man, with the various shafts, the king chamber, the queen chamber, which that points towards Orion and Sirius and the Draco shaft, in which that points towards Thuban, which is in the Draco constellation, which used to be the North Star. Now, this all correlates to the brain structure. Another interesting point about the brain is the 12 pair cranial nerves, as we spoke of earlier. Now, when you go to your Bible, Revelation, the 4th chapter, the 4th verse, it says, around the throne was 4 and 20 elders. Well, it says here, around the throne was 4 and 20 seats, and upon the seats I saw 4 and 20 elders sitting, clothed in white raiments. And they had on their heads crowns of gold. And the 420 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that sit upon the throne forever and ever and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Amen, hallelujah. Now, you go to Rudolf Steiner's information. He's the founder of Anthroposophical Society. He was with Madame Blavatsky. He's one of the teachers of Adolf Hitler. But interesting note, these occultists had a lot of information in which that they studied and mastered. You must do the same. But it says the zodiacal nature is microcosmically reflected under the dome of the human brain or the human being's skull. The highest of those three are the cranial nerves, of which there are indeed 12 pair as follows. So these 12 pair, you have what is known as the optic nerve, the oculomotor nerve, the triocleural nerve, the trigeminal nerve, the abducens nerve, the facial nerve, the vestibular clavicular nerve, the glossophageal nerve, the vagus nerve, hypoglossal nerve, and the accessory nerve. Those are the 12 pair of cranial nerves, which symbolizes pair means two. So 12 times two is 24. So hence the 24 elders, which we just talked about in Revelation 4:4, as well as King Arthur and his 12 knights that sat at the round table, Jesus and his 12 disciples at the Last Supper. All of this is symbolic to that. All right. So I'm going to leave that information right there. We're going to go to the phone lines because we got some questions. 757, you're on the line.
Peace.
Peace.
Yo, what's good, Aleem?
Not much, God. What's up?
Yeah, man, you going in, man. I like how you know what I'm saying, you're putting it out there. You mentioned earlier, did you mention the Council of Nicaea?
Right.
Okay, now when did that happen?
In 325 AD.
Okay, so then if that took place, because that's, you know, that's the whole, you know, the traditional way it's put out there that it happened 325 AD. So that must have been the whole clergy was black then.
Basically. You had the Coptic Christians. Arian was Ethiopian or Coptic, in which that actually that's what sprang forth the first popes, in which that sat on the throne of Rome. There was at least three black popes in history, you know, notably, and they sprung forth from the Ethiopian or Coptic Vatican, which actually was called the Holy Church.
Okay. Is that the time of the Etruscans?
Well, the Etruscans were the original Romans, all right, of Rome. So, yes, that would be during that time period.
Okay. Yeah, because, I was wondering about the Council of Nicaea because I was thinking possibly it could have been later, more recent than what they were saying, but okay, but you're saying it did happen 325.
Well, all of the information, it could have been later from what we're saying. All of it could actually be later. It doesn't have to actually go back that far, but that is where historical accounts claim and put it at, but we know who is writing history right now, so we can't believe anything because, as Napoleon said, history is nothing more than a lie agreed upon. You know,
that's
so
correct.
If you're thinking that it could have been later, then guess what? It possibly could have been based on the fact that we found out that the Greek history was fraud, It didn't exist. And that the original Greeks, you know what I'm saying, were who?
Yeah, that's what I'm getting to. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Exactly. So the original Greeks were the Minoans. And the Minoans were from out of Egypt because they was from they was the followers of Men, which is Amen, which becomes the Minoans, you know, in Athens and also within Greece, in which that that information of the Etruscans, all of that was one in the same family in that regard. So hence you have the Greco-Roman mythologies in which they actually came from out of Ethiopia. And it tells us that within Herodotus, when he breaks down specifically that Apollo and Zeus were Ethiopians.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was
right,
wondering
and
about.
And for people who want to do more research, they can get that information from J. Rogers, Sex and Race, Volume 1, as well as also from What They Never Told You in History Class by Indo-Kemet Kush. So you're definitely on point, guard, no doubt about it. You know what I'm saying? I don't trust in a lot of the dates, but I have to give it based on what they claim historically. And so when people go back, they can do the research, you know what I'm saying, and come possibly to the same conclusions that you and I can come to that actually was later time. But, you know, we'll go right now with that 325 AD nonsense because this is what is written historically.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I needed to know, man. I appreciate that, man.
All right, God. Peace.
All right. Peace, God.
Peace, God. All right. We got caller 919. 919. Area code 919. You on the line.
Yo, what's up, Brother Lane?
Peace, God.
Peace. What's going on? I just had a question. I was listening to one of your lectures not too long ago, excuse me, and you was talking about the 3-minute breath technique. Like three breaths per minute.
I was doing
10 seconds in, 10 seconds out. Do I pause 1 second in between on that too?
No, you don't have to.
Not on that one?
No, not on that one.
Okay. And I had one other question. As far as the penile, like what's the best breathing technique to open up my third eye when I'm doing like my meditations and stuff?
Well, actually, the best thing is actually to focus your eyes up towards, you can actually crisscross your eyes in a sense. Or close your eyes and focus that up, you know, to the middle of your eyebrow.
Oh, okay.
And that actually what opens it up, and you don't even have to focus so much on the breath in that regard. But if you do, just breathe in, you know, deeply and breathe out, you know what I'm saying, deeply, you know, just be relaxed. But just by doing that, that opens and awakens the pineal gland, and you'll feel the sensation in between your eyebrow.
Okay. How long?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry, brother. Go ahead.
Okay, go ahead.
No, I was just wondering, like, when I'm doing the 3 breaths per minute technique, how long should I do that daily? Because I've been practicing, I'm doing it, but I didn't know how, like, what was the, you know, to really get my full capacity of my aura.
Right, it would be an hour.
An hour? Okay. Cool. And I just want to let you know, brother, I will be down for the Atlanta lectures. I'm up here in Raleigh. I've been following you for a while, and I've been meaning to come down to the store, but I've just been busy. But I'm going to still come down to your store down in Fayetteville.
No, we closed it. We're getting ready to reopen up in Raleigh.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, we're getting ready to reopen it right there in Raleigh. So that's what we've been looking for is a building. In order to reopen it in Raleigh. So just stay tuned, and we'll get more information to you on that.
Oh, peace, God. That's perfect. Yeah, then that can be perfect access to all the information. I love that. But I'll make sure I'll be down in Atlanta to see you live for the first time. So I'm you know, really excited about that, to get the information and the energy and everything. So I can, you know, that'd be my first, like, real live lecture.
All right, no doubt. Bring everyone that you can.
Yeah, I'm bringing my queen with me. Me and my girl coming down there, so we're gonna ride down. We're gonna enjoy ourselves and have a good time, and you know, feel all the energy, try to obtain all this knowledge and get ready for everything that's going on.
No doubt. All right, appreciate you. All right,
peace, God.
Peace, God. All right, going to call it 302. Area code 302. You on the line? 302. Peace. Area code 302. ending in 0680. Peace. All right, we're going to call it 313. 313 area code. You're on the line.
Hello.
Peace. How you doing?
I'm good. And you?
Doing well.
Good. Is there like a book or something that can give me the information you just gave, like just like you gave it?
No, there is no books that can give you that, but I can give you about a dozen of books in which that has bits and pieces of what I just gave.
Man, I thought you didn't make anything yet.
Yeah, I got my own book that I wrote in which that gives you everything in it, if that's what you're talking about.
That's what I'm talking about.
Well, my book is The First World Order. And also another one is Out of the Womb, Into the Mind. So The First World Order.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go to our website, www.cultural-freedom.com. That's C-U-L-T-U-R-E.
Yeah, I've been there.
All right. So you can go there and order The First World Order.
Mm-hmm.
Or either Out of the Womb, Into the Mind. And Out of the Womb, Into the Mind is $35.
So which one is more comprehensive? Or do I need them both to?
Out of the Womb, Into the Mind is very is very good.
And they're giving me what you're saying right now. Because another thing I was interested in, and I went to the site, was looking for something about the, this is kind of off topic, but about the, you know, the healing herbs and stuff like that. I wanted something like comprehensive about that too. You know, you have something with that?
Yeah, you can go to our other website, www.freewebs.com,
mm-hmm.
/raka/again. That's www.freewebs.com,
mm-hmm.
/raka, which is R-A-K-A, /again. And you go there, and you can look up, we got quite a bit of information on that website.
You know, I couldn't really, I went there too, and I didn't know what, I just didn't know.
right.
Is there like a book or, you know what I'm saying, is there something?
Okay. That still would be the Out of the Womb, Into the Mind.
Okay, that's in there too.
Right. Now I have a new book that's coming out, which is called The Blueprint to Better Health.
Okay. It's not out yet?
No, but it's coming out within the next month or two.
Okay.
And it's called Blueprint to Great Health. And that will have a lot of the herbs, in particular the sea vegetables, such as Irish moss.
I did a lot of writing when you did that before.
right. So that book will be out very soon. So we'll be dealing with that also. So just.
Yeah, I will be getting, I'll order that other one, and then I'll be looking for this one too, because I'm trying to get into that.
Okay.
You know, the all-natural thing and helping the folks around here too. Got a lot of ailments around this way.
Right. Right, I got you.
I really appreciate you. You give me a lot of good information.
Oh, appreciate you for listening.
No problem. If I had any questions, could I give you a call or something? Because I don't want to hold up this line.
Okay, well, number is 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588.
Is there a good time to call, to reach you?
Any time, you know, about 11 to 11.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you so much.
Just enough time for I can sleep.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much.
All right. Peace. Peace, Goddess. All right. We got another call here, 904 area code 904. You're on the line. 904? Please.
Huh?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah.
What's going on, God?
Huh? Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Chilling.
Right, you have some questions?
I gotta find that letter, you know.
Okay. You just listening? Okay, well, we appreciate you, Op. All right. We're going to go to caller 860. 860, you're on the line. 860, area code.
What's going on, Big G. Alem?
What's up, God? How you doing?
Peace. It's our Seth L. Day. You already know.
Right, right. How you doing?
I'm doing. I'm hanging in there, man. I just wanted to call you and let you know I'm listening to you live.
Okay, okay.
You know, show you some great respect from the Spirit of the Most High God.
Appreciate that.
You know, I thank you for giving me the science on the Kundalini energy from my spine and focusing on another area of my body as I'm going through this anxiety and panic attack.
Exactly. How has that worked for you?
It's been helping me out. I actually been getting sleep, even though I still feel like I'm suffering from like heavy brain migraines. But I'm struggling with focusing every day on that different part on that part of my body, and it's keeping me from having the attacks as far as my lungs go. Or my
right.
So I do understand that it's a mental thing that we're struggling with as far as our negativity thought or our positivity thought and also our eye of Horus. I like the illustration on the picture that you got up there when I see the pictures changing, I like it because I've never really looked at that. And I understand that 7 is the number of God and 6 is the number of equality. And, you know, certain people without infinite ability are stuck at 6 or 6.5 and are now reaching 7 and beyond. So, you know, I gotta remain 7 and beyond. And I actually get frustrated with this disorder, man. So I really appreciate the information that you gave me, and I build on it every day.
No doubt. I appreciate you for listening and seeking me for advice, and you know, I'm glad I was able to help you.
Yes, sir. You know you got to come back up here and talk to the people, man. Sit up here back in the space, man. Come back up here in Connecticut and help us out here in our offer, God.
Okay, no doubt.
No doubt. I appreciate you. All right,
you know, so, hey. But y'all get me to come, I'm coming.
Yes, Father, you already know. So, you know, I'm just looking into the space, you know, and looking to invest into it. And then I want you to come up here, and I'm going to help out as far as anything I could do, man. I've just been blessed with your words, Father, you know what I'm saying. And you are definitely appreciated by me, and I feel like you're favored in the eye of the Most High positive energy.
No, I appreciate that. I'm trying to stay in the eyes.
Sure. Oh, yes, sir. I'm so happy right now. Just keep on talking to us, man, for the rest of our life.
All right, I'll meet you, God.
All right, peace.
All right, we got caller 786. Caller 786, you're on the line. 786.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Peace. How you doing, God?
Peace. All right, God. Malik down here in Dade County, Florida country. Much honor, peace, and respect and love to you and the family for spitting and hurling truth at falsehood until we all collectively can knock his damn brains out. So
hey,
we give
no
much
doubt.
Honor and praise to you, my brother.
I appreciate that, Ak.
About a month ago, this is outside of subject matter, but I can make it brief. About a month ago, I know you touched on dealing with the policeman, you know, stopping brothers on the bikes and, you know, traveling on the roadways. I had some vital information on there particularly for the Moors, but also too for the family. But I don't really want to touch on it now. It's outside of the subject matter in a sense. But I can come back in the next show and then expound on it. And then this is one of the effective protocols that our people can use in building these lawsuits against these policemen. But I can touch on it next time, because I know some other brothers and sisters may have their hands up pertaining directly to your subject matter.
Well, what we're going to do is actually we'll dedicate a show to that next week, and you can come on and give your information. How about that?
All praises is always due to the Holy One from the Mount Paran.
Right, all right.
Yes,
so
indeed. I can do that, God. I can do that.
All right, so we're going to do lawsuits and right to travel lawsuits, you know, and whatever else we come up with as far as a topic, and we're going to deal with that matter definitely next week. So just keep that in mind, and I'll keep it in mind, and definitely come back on the line, and we can get right into it.
Oh, wonderful, God, wonderful, God. Okay, thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Peace.
Peace, God.
All right. Area code 336. Area code 336. You're on the line.
Yeah, what's going on, brother Aline?
Peace. How you doing?
I'm doing all right, man. Just getting over a little cold. I want to know if you can elaborate on the Gnostic Gospels. I've been reading about that, reading about the Demiurge and about how that's the
You're talking about Adolabroth. And breaking out of his mother Sophia's womb too early.
Yeah.
That is nothing more than talking about our solar system, our sun particularly, was formed from the implosion of the star constellation Sirius B. So the womb would be actually the Sirius constellation, which is Sophia, which is wisdom. That's what it symbolizes, in which that we broke out from. Our solar system was formed and made too early. Or, you know, our sun was a raging sun at the time in which that the solar plasmic energy in which that was cast off from the sun is what formed the planets in orbit, in which that gave us approximately 10 structures, I guess you would say, or 10 objects in which that became known as planets, in which that with the various other moons and, you know, satellites, as they're called, or whatever the case may be. All that came from our sun, you know, giving birth to our solar system. So hence, Adolabroth was symbolic to our sun. And then it had the ability in order to form, but it didn't have the ability in order to put spirit or life into it. That came from our rotation with the Sirius B constellation, which is, like I said earlier, every 25,920-some-odd years, we travel around our solar system and Sirius constellation travel around each other in an elliptical pattern. So Sirius is what put actually life into our solar system, in which that would, it says Nomo. You know, this same story is told in the Dogon. The Dogon speaks about Ogo and Nomo. Nomo, Ogo broke away from his mother Amma, in which that Amma sent Nomo in order to put the life or the spirit or to be the sacrifice, of energy, I guess you would say, you know, inside of this particular solar system. So this is the same story told within the Dogon mythology too. Is that Amma, which symbolizes the mother-father principle, who sent forth Nomo because Ogo broke away from out of the womb too early and was defiant, and he thought that he was the only one, you know, and which that Amma ended up telling him that you're not the only one, you know. There was one who was before you, you know. So the one in which that is before is talking about the energy in which that is prior to the visible spectrum in which that we can see. In other words, the invisible. And that invisible energy is what we now call within the mental netta Amen, Amen Ra, that hidden substance, that hidden force, or that hidden light in which that is what actually backs our existence. In other words, you see the physical body, but that ruach, or that spirit, or that soul, or wind, or air, is what was blown into the nostrils of man and made man a living soul. And that goes for every planet in this solar system. According to Elijah Muhammad, there was at least 7 planets in this solar system in which they had life on them.
Hey.
So that's actually what the Gnostic text is actually talking about, just formation of the planets and the sun and how it broke away from the womb as that dollar brought from out of the mother's womb, Sophia, which is Sirius B in particular. And, of course, Sirius B symbolizes Orset, which is Isis, within the ancient Egyptian mythology.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, man, and it's like another little thing I wanted to share with you, too, right quick, man. From time to time, I talk to this spiritual medium from time to time, and she made contact with my cousin who had recently passed. And he shared something, you know, he channeled something through her, and she told me that he said that a lot of people don't realize that everything that we do, he said, we already done planned it out before we jump into this body.
Right, exactly.
I bet. That was just something real deep right there. You know, I was like, man.
And it's true. And so that's the point of what I'm talking about. That's us before the physical apparent reality was formed. So before Adolabroth, there was Nomo. You know what I'm saying? Or there was Christ, who existed prior to Adolabroth. In other words, the invisible consciousness. The consciousness existed before the physical body, before the physical structure.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Appreciate it.
All right. Peace out. Peace, God.
Peace.
All right. We're getting ready to end the show. And we appreciate y'all for checking us out once again. And we'll be getting ready to roll out.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt.
All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.